Good afternoon. I'm J.D. Hoovener, and welcome to the Bold Patents Show. I'm here with my trusty co-host, Matt Colseth. Matt, how are you today, sir?
Doing awesome. Just busy, busy, busy. Busier than a one-eyed cat watching two mouse holes, man.
Busier than a one-eyed cat watching two mouse holes. That's the first one. Gosh, that sounds like, you know.
It's pretty busy.
Old-timey kind of saying.
Yep. I'm from Minnesota, man.
I like it. I like it. How was your Valentine's?
It was good. Mrs. K and I went out to dinner last night and had a nice time and
good.
Got home and went to bed.
That's awesome. I opted for the lunch. Took my wife out for lunch. We got poke and ramen. And then it was funny. I did a last minute purchase before I got some CBD massage jelly and a I was hard working last night. I was doing massages.
I went cheap, man. I wrote a poem. That's what I did.
Oh, that's from the heart, Matt. That's yep. Great.
Yep.
Well, if we have time, we'll have you recite it on air.
Sure. Happy to do it.
For those of you joining us for the first time, I do want to make sure you know that we are attorneys, but this is not the forum to ask confidential legal questions. All right. Unfortunately, we're going to provide a link so you can do just that and schedule time with our firm. I'm a patent attorney. Matt over there is a trademark attorney. And we're going to be talking about IP, intellectual property, patents, trademarks, copyrights, maybe even a couple of trade secrets if we get into it. So I'm excited to see if we have any live participants. I see we got one out there right now, and then we have some others on LinkedIn that we can't tell. LinkedIn doesn't tell us how many live folks we have. So broadcasts are all going on. We're here every Wednesday. So if you're watching this after the fact on a recording, you can catch us live 1:30 Pacific, 4:30 Eastern every Wednesday. We're here. Unless one of us are sick or, you know, it's a major emergency holiday, that type of thing. I'm excited to have a wonderful guest on. I was a guest on his show a couple weeks ago. He's from Florida, Rodrigo Lima. I'm going to bring him on. Rodrigo, welcome to the show.
What's up, everybody? How you doing?
Doing great. I was trying to introduce you. So you were owner, founder at LimeDesign in Florida. Yep. Tell us a little bit about your firm, your design firm, and then we can get into some of the good questions that I've got.
Awesome. So what we do is, I mean, we're a full service product development firm from conceptual development and, you know, sitting with the client when they first sparked that idea all the way through helping them take it, do the research, design the product, do the engineering and 3D printing, prototyping, packaging, all the way straight through, all the way to manufacturing. And we also work very closely, as this is a field of intellectual property. So, you know, the patent attorneys are very important in creating intellectual property. And we work with them very early in the process. So we are a full service product development firm specialized in consumer products and consumer electronics.
Love it. Thank you. Well, and we have four people live on LinkedIn. So you've got a pretty good sized team there. Is that right?
We do. We got a team of 10, and we also work with about five others that are kind of like just more specialists that are kind of more, on the contractual side of things.
Awesome. Good stuff, man. Want to see some amazing stuff behind you, all sorts of different things. Got some faces, some toys. Maybe pull something off the shelf. I don't know. We didn't script this, but
show us a little something. I can share this one with you guys. So this is basically a cell phone case that has a refillable perfume vial inside of it. So basically you would just take off the top of the perfume and of your bottle, of your favorite perfume or cologne, and just squirts, pours it right in here. There's a check valve here, which allows you to refill it without worrying about any of it coming out. And basically what you have is a button here where you just push that and you get your perfume if you're on your way to a show or meeting up with that hunky dude or whatever, you know what I'm saying? So this is one of the...
I think my wife would like that for sure. Just trying to freshen up, you know, or I could use a little cologne here and there, a little jail shower and whatever to kind of get...
And technically it could be used for other stuff. I mean, you could use hand sanitizer if you really wanted to as well. It could be used and it can later be turned into other applications. I can personally see other applications. I mean, if you wanted to do like a self-defense device, maybe that can be turned into that with some modifications. But in general, it's a refillable vial that allows you to squirt and spray it and refillable.
Love that. Okay.
That's one of the recent ones that, and
that's cool.
Really, with all the nice details, man, with like that velcro, can you see how velvety that is on the inside there? So
I trust you. Yeah. It looks nice.
And then the feeling of it, it's this is called soft touch, where it's kind of slightly rubbery, but it's smooth rubber. I don't know. So it's it gives you that tactile feel of it. And, you know, everything starts with a prototype first, you know, a sketch and then a prototype. So this was a rough prototype that we created. See how the button was a lot different back then. And, you know, through designing the product with the client and trying different things out, we're able to get to a better solution.
So, perfect. Hey, this is a good example. Maybe we can just use this one if that's cool with you. Walk me through kind of, if you can remember it, you know, if you worked on it, how that client came in, what was like the first thing, the first meeting, how ready did they have to be? You know what I mean? If I got a product and I'm wondering, gosh, should I hire a designer or not? Where do they need to be in the process?
I mean, with my team, we helped them from the very beginning. From the day you have an idea, you're like, wait, I think it'd be cool to do this and add this and this and do. So we helped them from the very beginning. This client came to me after he'd already had an experience working with another team. I think he was working with a Chinese team or something. I don't recall exactly the details of it, but
okay.
Basically they made a prototype that didn't work, had a ton of problems with it. And, you know, one of the big things that I have to face every client that I, you know, specifically if somebody doesn't have a lot of experience, is that they expect it to be perfect on the first prototype. And the reality is that that doesn't exist. It just doesn't. Like, you learn so much from the first prototype that there's like obvious and necessary modifications that should be made, especially if it's something that you hold in your hand. For example, you might need it to be more ergonomic. Like, for example, this cutting knife here is a project I did with Husky about 5 years, 6 years ago. So, okay. You know, getting that design perfect to your hand is difficult because it's not regular 3D modeling. This is like more complex curvature. There's stuff going on from all sides. So it's not just a standard, easy to do product, you know, and
it's going to take some iterations. It sounds like, right. You're going to get the trials and, you know, multiple, you know, versions, you know, to get it just right.
Yep. And okay. It also depends, you know, prototyping is one of these things where there's the right type of prototype for the right times, right? For the right stage of the project that you're in. Because, you know, imagine it's more expensive, right? There's a greater investment if I want to make a perfect looking prototype every time, right? So, so a lot of times we go with just a rough prototype so that we can first learn and see, hey, I like that volume. It's about the right size, right? You have a good feeling about the overall size and feel of the product before we start making more complicated prototypes, right?
Got it.
So later you would go to something like this. Or here's another example where, you know, this is the final product here, right? It's got actuating, turns on and off.
Oh, wow. There you go. Cool. So I got a clip-on flashlight with like emergency flashers.
Yep. This was also sold at Home Depot in their value products in the front of the stores.
So that white or yellow shit, that's the first, basically the first product ready model.
I mean, yes.
How far do you have to get to that point?
I mean, in what regards? In time, total time?
I mean, it kind of almost looks kind of functional. I mean, so I'm just saying time period. Yeah, let's say if I come in the door, how long between when I first meet you from when I can get something that looks like that?
Probably, I'd say probably be about a month or so to get to the first product. Because
that's not too bad,
Research, then you have your conceptualization, and then your 3D modeling, so that I can have something in the computer that I can print out in a prototype form.
Okay, let's talk about that next step, right? Going from there to a actual product, manufacturing the whole nine. What has to happen there?
All right. So, like I was saying, there's different steps in the prototype, right? So the first prototype would be something more like I showed you, right? Something like this. The next prototype could be something more like this one right here, where, you know, you could see it was painted or it's in the same color that we imagine the product in. We're playing with the translucencies. Now, this is more of an aesthetic prototype, though. It doesn't have the electronics in it. It's a semi-functional aesthetic prototype, right? So
that's a long word. Semi-functional
aesthetic. Yeah. So it's
aesthetic prototype. Okay.
So the look, it's meant to look, you know, like a finished product, right?
Right.
And that looks more like a finished product, right? Then it still looks like a prototype. I mean, somebody that knows, but but it's further along. So parts, you know, in here you can see we printed everything as one almost, except for this piece here in the bottom. Everything else is one solid piece. In here, we're separating all those parts and making things function. So it's semi-functional because it doesn't have the electronics in this one.
Sure.
And then you have, this is considered a pre-production prototype. So this has all the electronics in it, the batteries you can see. Now it's not in the same color as it would be in the real world. And it's not technically necessary. The importance is making sure that the files are correct. There's nothing missed before they go into manufacturing. Because when you start making molds, making changes costs you 10, 20 times more because you might have to change a part on the mold and you also you'll lose a lot of time as well. So the prototyping allows us to think the idea through so that we can catch any areas to optimize now as opposed to having to get final manufactured parts and then we figure out that, oh, those parts aren't working perfect. So now you have to make changes and get new tools cut. And that's costly and timely. I mean, it takes a lot of time, you know?
Yeah, for sure. No, I mean, are you manufacturing all of that? Would you make that all in-house or is some or part of that going to be done by a third party?
No, manufacturing, we handle strictly third party.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So you're going to figure out the right source to go find and make that and get it to
the customer.
Yes. You're just doing the design. Do you do any manufacturing in-house?
Some short run I can handle in-house, but I typically don't.
Right.
It usually works out better to work with one of my partners that specifically focus on, you know, if it's a silicone part, then I want to work with somebody that does that every night and day. So we have certain partners for plastic, wood, metal that we just use throughout the years and created some strong partnerships with. And I'd rather work with them on a lot of this stuff. So for the manufacturing, it ends up being faster.
Yep. And sorry for all the questions. I'm just trying to put myself in client's shoes, you know? So one of the things that I think they might be worried about is what are they going to be doing as the product matures, as it develops? What do you see clients doing? Are they going to market doing testing? What are some things where you found the most, I don't know, where you've seen clients succeed in getting the product to be sellable as the product matures? What are some things that your clients have done that you've seen? Oh yeah, that makes sense. That's great. Good.
So I have one client. Can you throw me the sud stud, please? Yeah, you can grab all of that. So I'm not sure. This was actually a really good prototype that we made. So the sud stud, this is the final product. It's basically soap on a rope, right?
Right.
It's a silicone sleeve. Comes packaged like this, simple packaging with a small piece of rope there. And the product is basically makes it like a soap on the rope. So you have a little cleaner environment for your soap to live in. Doesn't leave a mess, right?
I love it. Yeah.
And this is actually like what I like to recommend like people do as a first product is like something simple. Because, you know, you want to learn on an easy product and then you can get into more complicated things later. That's my... how I like to do these things. Mm-hmm. But this is an example of a prototype mold that we printed in-house.
Okay.
Right. So sometimes you can 3D print the product, the actual final part. And sometimes like these here are 3D printed.
Mm-hmm.
And then we make a mold in a high resolution 3D printer and then use caulking. Basically using like a caulking gun and you squeeze it into the mold or you put it into a vacuum chamber and cast it. So you get a part more like this. And the reason being that a cast part is always going to be almost always going to be better and more functional, right? Mm-hmm. Than something off a 3D printer, you know?
Yep.
This just doesn't, this doesn't
react naturally. A little more rigid. Yeah.
Right. You know, and, okay. So this client right here, we were talking about something that a client did that was like fantastic, right? Well, what they did is they went and put their product on Kickstarter, right? And okay. it takes work, man. It's a lot of work. But after he was able to get, he actually was able to get, I think it was like $70,000 or $80,000 on Kickstarter. And then while he's in manufacturing, he waterfalled basically and started a campaign on Indiegogo right after the Kickstarter campaign ended.
So okay. he used that money to kind of leverage it.
Yeah. Back-to-back wow. crowdfunding. I've never seen somebody do it before successfully. And this guy did it. His name's Dale.
Cool.
He crushed it, man. I mean, he sold over 200K just in the Kickstarter, you know, in his campaigns. So
that is cool.
And then the other thing that I think was really smart that he did is he turned it into a subscription model where now he makes his own soaps. And, you know, you just pick a couple soaps you like and you get them in the mail, you know, every month. So mm-hmm. anytime you can take a product or an idea, turn it into something that you can create that residual, that repeat, transactions, right? I think that's a nice way to do a business model that can succeed.
Absolutely. So even something that simple, you know, I got to ask this question. I think it's burning in some of these people's minds is, let's talk about an investment, right? What sort of costs we're looking at to get to that level, right? Where you're doing that custom molding. What are we looking at working with a firm like yours, ballpark, you know, in
15, 25. Yeah. If it depends if it has an, you know, electronics or not. So, but okay. typically if we're going through concept development, 3D modeling, mechanical engineering, technical documentation, round one of prototyping, refinements, round two of prototyping, refinements, round three, which is a final beauty prototype. And then from there, we'll typically do packaging design and sourcing the manufacturing. So that's like my premium package, I call it, which is basically your go-to-market strategy. And that typically starts at around 30K or so, depending on the complexity of the project. If it's got electronics, you can expect 50K plus. If it has an app, you can expect, depending on the, you know, we also do some app stuff and get, you know, 20 to 50K, depending on what you're trying to do. And so plus, right?
Right. Absolutely. And actually, I've got an example later on in the show, maybe a few minutes here. We're going to do a bold bite on a Shark Tank segment where it's an app. So I wanted to kind of get your, have you stay on to help us critique that. Okay. Matt, do you have any hot burning questions for Rodrigo before we go to that bold bite?
Yeah, Rodrigo, super cool. So I imagine, you know, there's lots of folks out there who are able to kind of help with specific products and services and that sort of thing and bring an idea from a concept to market in the prototyping process. Mm-hmm. What would you say is like your specialty or like what makes your group distinct? Like who's your ideal kind of client that you want to work with?
So we work well with funded clients, right? And startups. We like to take a wide variety of products. I think that's one of the things that keeps it fun for me and my team is that we never know what we're going to work on, man. It's, you know, it's always a wide variety and range of products that we work on. So I think that keeps it a lot of fun. You know, I like working with people, like I was saying before about like the consumer products, pet products. I love working on sports, hand tools, screwdrivers, flashlights, mechanics tools. I mean, I have a ton of experience doing those products. So I love those kind of products as well. But the clients that I like are typically 80% stubborn in general and 20% like they'll listen, right? Because if they're not stubborn to a certain degree, their idea is going to get either changed so much from what they originally thought it was going to be, or it's going to be, I like smart people that are able to understand when you should take advice, you know, like when you stick by your guns and it's like, no, it must have that feature, right? And you know, I'm here to help them bring it to life and visualize it as they see it and improve upon what they're bringing us. And I like to work with, I like to do business with people that have done business before, people that have run a firm, any business, it doesn't even matter what it is. It could be a lemonade stand, right? Whatever. But that person at least they understand how, what it takes to really build a business.
Sure.
Because I think a lot of people think that they come up with this, I got the golden tickets. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. They got this great idea and like, but so they come and they kind of use it almost like, you know, I don't know if you guys see that, but I feel like they use it almost like it's like a lottery, you know? And I don't see it like a lottery because I think a lottery is something that you can't really, you're just putting money in there and you don't really know if you're going to hit the number or not, right? But when you're creating a product, you are directly, and your idea are directly influencing the market, right? And you're the one that's going to, you know, sell the product or not sell the product. So
I heard you loud and clear. I mean, I think for sure we have similar types of clients, and our favorite clients are those that straight hustle. I mean, maybe is what you're getting at, right? It's going to take work, not just throwing money in a, like you said, like a you know, a gambling machine and just hoping it goes well. No, you've got to actually put in the time and effort. We want to see it through, have the stick-to-itiveness to get all the way through. We've only got 9 minutes left, and I want to talk more about, you know, how, you know, the tie between patents and design. I think it's critical. You know, as you're getting started in either way, it's important to balance it and kind of think through, is this something to move forward with on a patent protection or not? It's something to consider. And I'm sure you've come across this a lot, Rodrigo, where, you know, you've got a product that may be innovative. And that's kind of the gut question initially. What we work with clients, do you think this is new? Have you ever seen this before? At least speak with a patent attorney to get an opinion on, is it patentable? And if so, you can move in parallel paths. Would you concur with that?
Yeah, I mean, and I like to work with the people, with the patent attorneys early in the process, typically in the first phase, in concept development phase. I already want to have conversations with them, so I understand, you know, I can understand what their opinion is on, and we can work together to help create an amazing product, right? So those are the type of, so just so you know, JD, those are the type of lawyers I really like working with.
All right.
And you guys seem very much like that type of group too. So it's, it's about, you know, thinking it out together and helping create success stories for our clients, right?
Totally.
At the end of the day, we're going to get judged on what products we have in the market. And we should be judged by that, because, you know, we're professionals and we're out here working hard to get people's ideas out into the market. And, you know, just like you, you want to see those products come to life so that you can say, hey, I helped work on this product. I hope I worked on this one, right? And be able to grow that army of fans that that have seen what you've done, you know?
Absolutely. Rodrigo, we've got to move on to our next segment. Do you have, are you want to get, allow us to give your email address out to those of you want to follow up with the question? Okay. Yeah. I've got Rodrigo L at LimeCreativeDesign.com. Feel free to get with Rodrigo. You had one more thing to say?
I have one more quick thing to say on Shark Tank. One of my clients just made it to she just went to the TV show and did that. And it's going to air this Friday.
This Friday?
ABC from 7 to 9. We're going to be doing a watch party at the bar next door.
Nice.
Projecting it onto the big screen.
And can you say the product name? Can you give any hints or no? You can't tell.
It's the Chub Rub Patch.
And Chub Rub Patch. Okay.
Yeah, this is the patch that you put on your inside of your thighs or under your arms so that you create, so you don't chafe, for anti-chafing.
Nice. And, All right.
I have another product I can show real quick. Just 1 second. Because you guys will see it out on the market. So this is just an example of some of the patches, what they look like. And we've basically helped our clients create the shapes, packaging, manufacturing, shipping. So basically from start to finish, she took it, blew it up on social media. And, you know, I'm just really proud of her. It takes a lot of work. It takes so many no's to get to that yes, you know.
Totally.
You got to be a trooper.
All right, we're going to flip over. We're going to go to our share screen here. Thank you, Rodrigo, for that.
I'm going
to do our Shark Tank episode. Are you guys able to see my screen?
Not yet.
No.
All right, let's exit that. Here we go. StreamYard.
Time goes fast on the show, man.
It does. It flies. Here we go. Got it. Okay, and then check off.
Is a solution for unwanted loose change.
Matt, you got audio on that?
I got it.
Okay, good.
Sounds good.
Hello, sharks. My name is Jeff Witten. I'm from Mamaroneck, New York, and my company is CoinOut. I'm seeking $250,000 in exchange for a 7.5% stake of my company. Sharks. We've all been here. You're paying for your iced latte at the local coffee joint. Hey there. And your morning is off to a great start until this moment. Getting back loose change. Oh, I hate loose change. It's filthy. It doesn't fit in your wallet or your skinny jeans. Getting coins back from cash is a completely inefficient, annoying, and stupid way to transact. Instead, turn your loose change into easy money. Coin Out, the most convenient way to digitize your loose change. We're getting rid of those pesky pennies, allowing people to take full control over their money. Let me show you how it works. So you're paying with cash at a participating merchant, and your change is $1.34. After handing over the cash, you simply ask the cashier, "I'd like to coin out." When she turns the device, you simply enter your phone number into the device at checkout, and you can choose if you want to coin out just the coins, the 34 cents, or the full change, the $1.34, to your coin out wallet. Hit confirm, and boom, transaction's complete. You'll get a text message confirming the transaction along with instructions to set up your account online later. And the best part is, there's no app to download, no financial information needed, and no sign up required until you're ready to cash out. Sharks, carrying around coins simply doesn't make sense. So the next time you check out, coin out.
Can I pay with my coin out account next time I go to get a coffee?
That's one of the options. So we
have- guys, that's all the time we have right there. So I want to get Matt, I want to get your reaction first.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. I think, it's a practical solution, but I don't know how practical implementing it would be. So I'll be curious to see what you know about the sharks, what they did with it. But from a trademark perspective, they are a registered trademark. They have a word mark to protect the letters of the name, no design mark or anything like that. And they're in a variety of different classes and goods and services at the USPTO. So they've done a nice job just protecting their trademark from a robust IP perspective.
That's perfect. You know, Mike, because so that guy pitching is an attorney. I'm going to give him a round of applause. Kudos to a fellow attorney for doing that part, right? He did forget one thing. He didn't file for a patent application. Now, I'm not saying it necessarily was novel. Maybe he did the background research, got with the patent attorney, did a search, and found that really what he's doing isn't unique. That might have been the final punch that would have helped. He did get laid into by Kevin O'Leary. He's like, "You're going to get swallowed by the giants that are in this industry that handle all the money and the transactions." And he was worried that big companies would just do the same thing and just basically eat him alive. But he did win over one of the other sharks. I think it was Lori who actually invested in this company, or at least said she would. And then in 2021, went on to make $10 million in revenue with Cash App.
Right.
Successful. Yes, incredible. So, Rodrigo, I know we only have a couple minutes left. If you were head of this project and said, "Please make this app for me," you know, what are some of the things that come to mind for you? Some of the barriers, maybe some things you saw from that short clip that you wanted to mention.
I don't know. I mean, it's an interesting concept. I mean, it just has to be faster than putting the money in your pocket or something. You know what I'm saying? I mean, but I don't know. It's interesting, man. I mean, he's able to grow. You said $10
million? $10 million. Yeah. And one of the cool upsides.
What do I know, dude? You know what I'm saying?
That they did mention is that it builds a loyalty program. Right. What they do is people that have cash, they want to remain anonymous. It forces them in a way, if they want to get their money, to join that app later. So they say, "Oh, yeah, OK, I'll put that money online." Now they've got to go download the app. That was one of the cool things that got people moving and to download. I've never heard of it. And I don't deal with that ever. But apparently he was pretty well researched and found that 33% of all transactions are still cash today. So thanks for helping us with the critique. We had one question come in. I want to make sure Matthew gets some airtime. He asked, "How would you like to mold a product that holds kitchen utensils to panhandles on the stove while cooking? How would you mold it if it holds a kitchen utensil?" I don't know if I understand that exactly.
Probably something made out of silicone, I think, is what I would probably do. I would make a part that, so because typically it'll be a silicone, so it doesn't melt.
Okay.
High temperature.
Right. Yeah, I've got some of those little gloves to pull things out of the oven with the silica.
Right.
Okay. Yep. Love it. Well, go ahead. Time flies. It's we're out of time, and we had a couple great live questions. Rodrigo, thank you for your time. Matt, as always, thanks for being with me here, co-hosting. We'll be here next week. And Rodrigo, I got a feeling we're gonna have to have you back to talk through some of this.
I'm down.
No. I missed it. Check out your client, Chubby Rub Patch.
Chub Rub Patch.
I goofed that
on
up.
On ABC.
8 p.m.
Eastern Standard Time.
All right. We'll be there. And for all of us here at Bold Patents, wish you guys a great rest of your